discussing about sodium potassium pump. This sodium potassium pump, it is most common pump. It is most common pump seen in the plasma membrane of animal cells. So it's the most common pump. Whenever you see the plasma membrane of the animal cell, the most common pump which we have is a sodium potassium pump. This sodium potassium pump leads efflux of 3 sodium ions coupled with influx of 2 potassium ions. That means whenever this sodium potassium pump works, at what it leads efflux of, that means it's taking the 3 sodium ions out from the cell. Say for instance, if I am making here a plasma membrane, say this is a cell here I am making, it is having a double layer of the plasma membrane, this is a plasma membrane here. If I am making the pump here, sodium potassium pump, say I am highlighting this, say for instance this is here a sodium potassium pump. Now this sodium potassium pump, it leads the influx of 2 potassium ions. That means these potassium ions are taken from outer environment towards the inner environment and leads to the efflux of 3 sodium ions that are taken from intracellular matrix to the extracellular matrix. We have kept in mind the sodium potassium pump leads to the influx of 2 sodium ions, 2 potassium ions coupled with the efflux of 3 sodium ions. We have kept in mind. So this is the action or activity of the sodium potassium pump. Now one more important thing we have to keep in mind, this sodium potassium pump is also known as sodium potassium ATPase, because it is also having the site for the breaking down of ATP. ATP is broken down into ADP plus phosphate. That means that phosphate leads to the phosphorylation of sodium potassium pump. It becomes activated. When it becomes activated, it leads to the influx of 2 potassium ions coupled with the efflux of 3 sodium ions. Now the one more important thing you have to keep in mind, the sodium concentration in an extracellular matrix is very high. The sodium concentration in extracellular matrix is 145 millimolar, but its concentration within the cell is very less. It's about 5 to 15 millimolar. That means the sodium are taken from lower concentration to higher concentration. That means it's again as the concentration gradient. That is why if the transport takes place again as the concentration gradient, that transport is known as the active transport, and that transport is dependent on the ATP, that is dependent on the energy. That means that transport is also having the, that pump is also having the ATPase activity. It leads to the breaking down of the ATP into ADP plus phosphate, and that phosphate binds to this pump, leads to the activation of this protein, which leads to the influx of 2 potassium ions and efflux of 3 sodium ions. So we can say sodium potassium pump is also known as sodium potassium ATPase. You have to keep in mind, because it transports the things from lower concentration to higher concentration. Take one more thing, the potassium in an extracellular matrix is very low, it is about 5 millimolar, but in a treat it is 140 millimolar. That means the potassium also moves from lower concentration to higher concentration. So sodium potassium pump is actually showing active transport, leads to the movement of the ions from lower concentration to higher concentration, means again is the concentration gradient. Now one more important thing which we have to keep in mind, that is sodium potassium pump leads to, makes the membrane polarized. So if you take this plasma membrane, it has become polarized. The reason is If more sodium is expelled out, 3 sodium ions are expelled out, this leads to the external part of the plasma membrane, positively charged, makes it positively charged. So, 2 potassiums are in, but negative charge is more here. That means the inner side of the plasma membrane becomes negative. This positive and negative charge, which is located on the external and the internal environment of the plasma membrane, makes the plasma membrane polarized membrane. So, we can also call the very important point, that is sodium potassium pump activity makes plasma membrane polarized. That means inner side of the plasma membrane becomes the negative and outer side of the plasma membrane becomes positive. That is why we call sodium potassium pump is known as electrogenic pump. It is an electrogenic pump by creating the positive and negative charge. On the basis of that, we also call this pump as electrogenic pump. So the sodium potassium pump is actually dependent upon the phosphate. That means phosphorylation of the sodium potassium pump activated the sodium potassium pump and leads to the movement of the ions from lower concentration to higher concentration, which leads electrogenic, which makes the electrogenic pump means it makes the plasma membrane polarized. Now we will see in the next part of it, we will see the structure of sodium potassium pump. Now in the next video, or in the next part of it, we have a structure of sodium potassium. Now this sodium potassium pump, it is mainly formed of 3 units. It is mainly formed of 3 subunits. It is mainly formed of 3 subunits. The first unit which we have is known as an alpha subunit. Then we have next one is a beta subunit. Then we have a third one is a gamma subunit. So it is made up of a 3 subunits. One is an alpha subunit, and second one we have is a beta subunit. Then after the third one we have is a gamma subunit. Now taking the alpha subunit in a detail, say for instance, if I am making here a plasma membrane, again say this is a plasma membrane, I am making the roughly diagram of it. So this is a plasma membrane. Now taking this alpha subunit, it is the largest subunit. If we will take in detail the alpha subunit, is the largest subunit. You have to write down the largest subunit. When it is largest means, why we call it the largest? Because it is a transmembrane protein, but this transmembrane is a 10-pass transmembrane protein. That means it crosses the plasma membrane 10 times. If I am making you, say this is a 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and say this is 10. So it crosses the plasma membrane 10 times. That's why we call it as transmembrane protein, but it's a 10-pass transmembrane protein. So if you have to write down about the alpha subunit, so alpha subunit is the largest subunit. It's a transmembrane protein. It's a transmembrane protein. That means it is located within the membrane or it is moving through the membrane. So it's a transmembrane protein passing 10 times in the plasma membrane. It is alpha helical protein. You have to keep in mind the structure is alpha helical. That means it 10 times, so we can also call it as a 10-pass protein. It's a 10-pass transmembrane protein. You can also call it as a 10-pass transmembrane protein, means it 10 times crosses the plasma membrane. The most important thing, it's amino group on one side and the carboxylic group on another side. They both are intracellular. This is very important point which you have to keep in mind. That means it's amino group and COOH group, both are intracellular. That means they are facing the cytoplasm. That means they are towards the cytoplasm. They are located in the intracellular matrix. But it is a 10-pass protein, means 10 times crosses the plasma membrane. And the protein which is mainly present is the alpha helical protein. You have to keep in mind. Now, one more important thing about the alpha helical is, alpha helical is having the binding sites. It is having binding sites for sodium, potassium, and ATP. This is very important thing. So it's having all binding sites for, that means the sodium binds to it, potassium binds to it, then it also leads to the binding of the phosphate with the breaking down of the ATP. So we can say it's having the binding sites for sodium, potassium, as well as for the ATP. And we can also call it having the ATPase activity. It's also having the ATPase activity, means it is helping in a breaking down of ATP into ADP plus phosphate. This you have to keep in mind. Especially if you will take the alpha subunit, it's having the two domains. One domain we have is the N domain. It will mainly have two domains. One is the N domain where the ATP binds. Second domain is known as a P domain, where the phosphorylation takes place. So the main function of the sodium potassium pump is performed by the alpha subunit. If anybody asks you why, the most important thing is it is the largest subunit. It is a transmembrane protein. It's a 10-pass transmembrane protein, you can also call it. So it is having the amino group as well as the carboxylic, both are intracellular, you have to keep in mind. So it is having the binding sites for sodium, potassium, and ATP. It's also having the ATPase activity, which helps in a breaking down of ATP into ADP plus phosphate. It's having two domains, you have to keep in mind. N domain, which is for ATP binding, we see it in a mechanism of action. Then we have a P domain, which is for the phosphorylation. So this is about the alpha structure of the plasma, alpha structure of the sodium potassium or alpha subunit. Now next thing we have, that is a beta subunit. We see its structure in detail in a mechanism of action, but I'm making just a view here. Next thing we have, that is a beta subunit. Beta subunit is a single pass transmembrane protein. It's a single pass transmembrane protein. See, if I'm making here again a plasma membrane, so this is a plasma membrane, but both alpha and beta subunit, they remain in association. But you have to keep in mind, here it is a single pass. So this is a single pass protein. It's also alpha helical structure. A single pass protein it is. So it is present in association with the alpha subunit. What's its function? Its function is, it helps in a folding. It helps in folding, targeting, and anchoring. Of alpha subunit. That means when the alpha subunit is formed inside the rough endoplasmic reticulum, because it is a secretory pathway, because the protein is located within the membrane, so it is formed from a secretory pathway. So we can simply say when the protein is formed, when the alpha subunit is formed, is the largest subunit. By the rough endoplasmic reticulum, it moves through the Golgi apparatus. Then after, from the Golgi, it is transported into the membrane. are from the Golgi, with the help of the vesicles, it moves into the plasma membrane. It gets fitted there. But with it, it is also in the beta subunit. This beta subunit, it helps in a folding of this protein. Then it's helping in a target, which has a targeting sequence where it has to reach. And it's also helping in a fixing of this alpha protein here. So it also helps in a fixing of this alpha here, which is present inside the plasma membrane. So its function is folding, targeting, and anchoring of alpha subunit within the plasma membrane. One more thing that's more important, that is that we have the gamma subunit. Gamma subunit, its function is unknown, but it's made up of three or four crucial amino acids. It's made up of four crucial amino acids. But its function is still unknown, but it's made up of four crucial amino acids. The amino acids which we have is F, that's the phenylalanine. Then we have a XX, may be any amino acid. Then we have a Y, is a tyrosine. Then we have a D, is a aspartic acid. So it is made up of actually the four amino acids. F is a phenylalanine, which is an aromatic amino acid. Then we have X, may be any amino acid. It's any amino acid. It can be any amino acid. And Y we have is a tyrosine. Then D we have is an aspartic acid. So this Y subunit, its functions are unknown, but it's made up of four amino acids, crucial amino acids. F is a phenylalanine, which is an aromatic. Then we have X may be any amino acid. Then we have Y is a tyrosine, which is also aromatic or hydroxyl amino acid. Then we have D is an aspartic acid, which is an aspartic or acidic amino acid. So these four amino acids together make the gamma subunit, but very important thing is its function is still unknown in the sodium potassium pump. Now tomorrow we'll discuss about the mechanism of action of sodium potassium pump.